Hi, I'm Gabriella Levine. I work as an artist and a technologist, and I build robots. Two things in my early childhood greatly affect what I do now. When I was 8, I had Lyme disease, and my summer started off as a bad one. I couldn't go outside and play as I loved to. But what I did instead had immense impact. I stayed inside, and for hours on end, I built up giant masterpieces out of Legos. I also have always had an obsession with snakes, particularly the way they move. I've had snakes growing up as pets, and I've also done research in Arizona on desert snakes. These two passions, Legos and snakes, greatly influence my work now. I work in electronics, but I have a passion about building biological forms in hardware. Specifically, I build snake robots, but even more specifically, open source robots. I want to talk to you today about the power of sharing information and how open source could change the world. Last year, Richard von Oss, a South African construction worker, decided to design a set of mechanical fingers after he had an accident on the job. He lost 4 fingers, yet there was no pre-existing prosthetic that could fit his hand the way it was injured. So he decided to design his own. He was collaborating online with a man in Washington who he met on the web, who was a special effects artist who had just designed a mechanical hand. Then Richard got a MakerBot, which is a 3D printer that's consumer-friendly, pretty easy to use, and inexpensive. Now that he had this in his workshop, he was able to cut down his production time to what took weeks to just minutes. Now, if he made a mistake or broke a part, he was able to just print a whole new finger in just 20 minutes. And then he started publishing his designs online on a website called Thingverse, which is specifically dedicated for people to publish designs for the 3D printer, the MakerBot. And others started to see his success. One boy was Liam. Liam was born with no fingers on his right hand. And Liam's mother saw what Richard had created and asked if he could create Liam a new hand. And so he did. And for the first time, Liam was able to feel like what it felt like to grip a baseball. And then others started coming to Richard as well, like Dylan, and Dave, and Junior, and Isitu, and Angel, and Thomas, and soon others started building this hand in their own homes with the MakerBot based on Richard's design. This is a primary example of the power of sharing technology and open hardware. Open hardware is any hardware or physical technology whose design is shared for others to use, modify, and distribute. The open hardware movement has already begun to allow artists, designers, technologists, creators to have access to open technologies that are already proliferating into amazing innovations. Let me tell you about an open hardware project that I'm working on called Protei. Protei is a shape-shifting, unmanned sailing robot. It was originally designed to clean up oil and enable local communities to take an unmanned approach to cleaning up oil on the water. But now it's expanded into a general platform to allow people to use it for any type of ocean preservation and exploration. The unique part of Protei is that its hull moves flexibly like a snake. It's optimized to drag a long and heavy load on the water. Protei was started in the Gulf of Mexico by Cesar Harada. It was then, during the BP oil spill, that he was aiding the fishermen with the cleanup efforts. Cesar was an artist, an inventor, and an entrepreneur, and he was disheartened by seeing the terrible conditions in which they were working. The current methods for cleaning oil were using over 700 of these repurposed fishing vessels, driven through giant patches of oil on the water with oil-absorbent booms, but they only collected 3% of the oil, and they were extremely hazardous for the health of the workers. Czar knew immediately that what the world needed was an unmanned technology that could reach the hands of many. But Protei is not just for oil. We realized that if we could develop a system that could carry a heavy payload on the water, it could also carry sensors for things like measuring radioactivity off the coastline or even garbage collecting nets for picking up plastic trash. But these problems are huge and nobody could solve them alone. So we published our designs online and formed a centralized website, and an online community began to form of people from all over who wanted to collaborate to develop a new technology to have a sustainable method of cleaning the ocean with wind power. In summer 2011, I moved to Rotterdam to work in a giant workshop. We had electronics, wood, raw materials. It was the best summer of my life. I was working with artists, designers, engineers, naval architects, marine biologists. We came from all over together to develop the sixth and largest prototype. In just 3 months, we built together a 10-foot robotic sailboat that was able to drag a long oil boom behind it to absorb oil. There were problems, but we kept working on it. By the next summer, we had developed 4 more prototypes. We kept documenting the work and people kept working on the project. From the people who had started collaborating on the Protei project, a massive community was beginning to form. That's how we work. We work hands-on, we test often, and we document. Now people in Korea, Peru, Mexico have all built versions based on ours. I built this in New York and published my designs online, and students in the Netherlands copied and modified and improved the designs, and they published theirs, which was seen by over 11,000 people. We work with students and kids all over the world in workshops. Now we're aiming to manufacture and distribute boats and boat kits by the end of this year. We've gone all over the world, building and testing and user testing and field testing. We measured radioactivity off the coast of Fukushima in Japan, and we're talking with top ocean scientists about how to develop a system so Protei could sense plastic trash in the Great Pacific Gyre. Before starting Protei, I wasn't an engineer, but I did not have to be. As Richard learned by experimenting with the MakerBot 3D printer, all of the tools that I needed in order to get started building and coding were already available. What I had to learn was how to piece them together, and I did this only with patience and a lot of imagination and getting over the fear of failing. I worked a lot in open communities with people who were collaborating, and all of my knowledge coming about hardware, electronics design, even robotics, stems from these open communities. I did a lot of work in makerspaces, such as Tech Shop in San Francisco and NYC Resistor in New York, and it was from these open communities that I learned and I thrived. From Instructables and other websites where people share their innovations and designs online, I was able to build upon other successes. I was able to use pre-compiled code libraries and follow other schematics. And doing so, I was able to build up entire designs for sustainably powered robots and then share those designs back on Instructables. So just from experimenting with tools, experimenting with new media, and leveraging documentation, in a few years, I was able to develop enough skills to build my own snake robots and other type of robots to go out into the world and sense environmental data. It's from these open, collaborative communities that comes the amazing potential, but it's already proliferating into real innovations. The power is immense, and it's just beginning, but the tools and the tech and the communities are here. So it's not just scientists or engineers who could create and invent, but it's all of us. Every one of us has the capability and the knowledge to contribute to the ideas and the technology for world-changing concepts. Thank you.